Welcome back to part two of 7 Principles to Success. Now, how did you go with the first three principles? If you haven't listened to last week's episode, then go back after listening to this one and check it out. The first three principles are totally independent to these next four. Now, if you did give them a go and implemented them or tried them out, I'd love to get your feedback. So you can shoot me a message by clicking the link in the show notes or email me at chat@terrianepalmer.com. I really want to know, what was your experience of trying those first three principles out? Now, you know, nothing will work for you if you don't put them into practice or action. Now, a quick recap. Principle number one, treat all your results as experiments. They're neither good nor bad, just experiments that give you feedback. Principle number two, change from first person orientation to third person orientation to gain more space and perspective. Principle number three, using the momentum planner as your guide, no, I just added that in by the way, keep life simple. Ask yourself three questions and then fulfill those questions. All right, so let's get straight into principle four, because the last principle is an exercise I want you to try out. It's super powerful and I want to make sure you have time to do it. It's one of those things you want to tune into all the way to the end of this episode. If there was a guarantee that you could create your dream life, a life that truly mattered to you, would you want it? My name is Terriane Palmer-Peacock, and I'm delighted to welcome you to the One Person Podcast. I have a belief that one person can make a difference in the world. That person is you. It's me. When we show up as the best version of ourselves, when we create and live our dream lives, we make a positive impact on ourselves and those around us. So if simple, actionable, step-by-step strategies, tools, and tips on how to do that inspires you, then you are in the right place, my friend. So let's get started. Principle number four, creating a life you love is the best form of therapy. If you see someone who is depressed or anxious or upset about their life, it almost always comes down to one thing. Now, by the way, I'm excluding chemical imbalances, hormone discrepancies, all that sort of stuff. It typically comes down to the life they are choosing to live is not one they love. Now, I almost hear you saying, duh, that's not rocket science. But if you follow principle three and write down everything you want to feel and everything that makes you feel that way, and you choose to do those things during your day, then I guarantee you will love your life. If structurally and fundamentally you do these three things, you will be creating a life you love. And it's very hard to be unhappy when you're doing what you love every day. Now, I can already hear the objections being screamed at me. Well, of course I'd love my life if I was able to paddle every day, go hang out in the ocean, go for coffee with my friends, go shopping. We all have responsibilities and obligations. I get it. But if the story you are subscribing to is, I don't have the money to do the things that give me joy, I don't have the time to do the things that give me joy, then the problem you have is not a time or money problem, it's an attitude problem. And it's a lack of gratitude problem. You see, if you choose to look at the world as something that is perfect and glorious and in the process of working towards completion, that is, it's not complete yet and everything is happening in the natural order of all things, then everything can only be perfect. In fact, scientific reasoning says every living thing has one purpose in life, to advance or increase in life or to grow. Now, if we choose to believe this and we have the attitude and faith that the universe is conspiring to help us advance and grow, then our attitude should be one of gratitude. As Wallace Wattles, the famous author, says, because all things have contributed to your advancement, you should include all things in your gratitude. Now, this past 6 months have been a little tumultuous with my woman's paddling crew and the club that we paddle for. Now, to give you a wee story here, our crew wanted to take our paddling to the next level. We wanted to advance or increase our capabilities. We wanted to do extra training sessions. We wanted to train more as a crew so we could fine-tune our paddling together. Now, there were others in key roles in the club that felt that we were being divisive, self-centered, and quite frankly, they called us a lot of names and spoke incredibly poorly about us behind our backs. But my focus was on our end goals, and I chose to ignore what was happening outside of what I could control. Now look, I'd be lying if I said that I did that every time there was a conflict that happened, and I'm sure my husband would tell a very different story to the one I'm telling you now. But now that we're on the other side of it, I'm choosing to focus on the outcomes we achieved, which was a very successful Nationals campaign and the successful completion of all my personal goals. Now, since Nationals, I've taken a few weeks off paddling at the club and I've gained some valuable perspective. Had those challenges not been given to me, I may not have realized how much I still like competing and how I want to surround myself with people who believe in the same values as me. My experience and dissatisfaction has encouraged me to explore other clubs and other options, and I've met some wonderful paddlers from outside our club. I've experienced other paddling water conditions, which has given me immense gratitude for the water conditions I currently get to paddle in. I've experienced a different coaching style, which I absolutely love. The format, the organisation, the pre-planning, oh, it's so up my style, so ticks all my boxes. I absolutely love it. So looking back, the entire experience was for my advancement. So how can I not view it with gratitude? That's the attitude I'm adopting, which allows me to be the winner when I think about everything that has occurred. And for me, that's what I call the best form of therapy. Principle number 5, choose to inform your present self from the future, not from the past. We all have a past. We also all have a future. In fact, there are infinite possibilities in our future. Now, if you choose to believe this statement to be true, then you are well equipped for this principle. If not, then this principle most probably won't work for you. You must believe there is infinite in all directions and everything is accessible to you. Now, to go deeper into this discussion is definitely another episode. So for now, I recommend you trust me on this one if you're sitting on the fence. Just act as if. What I want you to do is think about your greatest goal or a vision you would love to create. Somewhere, at some time, on some dimension, you have already created it. That future you has already achieved the goal. Now, if the future you has already achieved the goal, then the future you also knows the path of least resistance to achieve the goal. It already knows how to do it in the quickest and easiest way. Now, what happens with most people is they allow their past self to inform you of your next steps. For most people, the past feels safe. That's why they do it. But the past is your current knowledge. It's what you already know. If you're creating a true goal, something you've never experienced before, then your past self has also never experienced it before. It has never created it, so it doesn't know. Now, how many of you feel uncomfortable when you don't know something? Now, I was driving my son to a Bond University Ideas camp yesterday, and he was nervous. He didn't know what the camp was about. He didn't know if he would know anybody there. He didn't know where the building was or how he was going to get there. And he was nervous. So I asked him, on a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being totally full of anxiety and nervousness, what number was he? And he answered, 7. So I said, good. I want you to acknowledge that number and how you are feeling. But instead of thinking it's a bad feeling, I want you to consider a different perspective. The only reason you feel nervous is because you don't know. You've never done it before. But that also means you're about to create something new. And when you're creating something new, how does that make you feel? And he said, well, a little bit excited. It makes me look forward to it. Exactly. So I said to him, when you feel nervous or anxious about something you don't know, get excited because you're about to create something new or you're about to experience something new, and that is something to look forward to. So not knowing is a good thing. When you have a grand goal or vision, you won't know how to achieve it, but the future you will. So go into the present moment and be okay with not knowing, and then ask your future self to give you 3 effective action steps that you can do today to move you closer to your goal's completion. Don't just do what you already know how to do. That is being informed by your past and it won't move you forward very fast. Make the conscious choice today, in the moment, to be informed from your future you. Principle number 6, your power is a series of moments. If something is not going according to your plans, you have the power to stop and recalibrate where you are at. In the moment, you can choose to change your attitude. You can choose to find something to be grateful for. You can choose to change direction. You can choose to stop what you are doing. You can choose to start doing something. You can choose how you want to feel. The key here is you have all the power. No one else. The power is all yours. So choose wisely. Choose often. Awareness is the key. If something is not going well, choose again. If something is going well, then you get to choose again as well. And principle number 7. Okay, this is actually an exercise. So this is going to be interesting if you're driving or if you're doing something where you're just listening to it. You may not be able to do this, so you might have to pause and come back to this. But what I want you to do is I want you to get a blank piece of paper, and I want you, just wherever you are, to get 10 items, 10 or more items. Can be anything around your desk, in your handbag, on somebody else's desk, who knows, credit cards, wallet, whatever, okay, 10 things. Then I want you to get your phone or a watch, and I want you to set a timer for 2 minutes. What you're going to do is you're going to create an assemblage, which is a three-dimensional collage, using the blank piece of paper and the items you gathered. But you're going to do it in a specific way. So follow my directions as we go through the exercise. All right. Now remember, pause this if you need to go and get those items. And when you're ready, you can press play again. Okay, let's do this. Number one, step one, look at the paper. Do not try to put anything in the space yet. Just let it be blank. There is nothing wrong with the blank piece of paper, and it's not going to be your goal to rid the world of another piece of paper. Just study the paper. Now, in your mind only, begin to form an idea of the collage you are about to make. Do not think about the materials you happen to have. Instead, think about the shapes you would like to see your collage have. What are the rhythms you want to feel for it? The textures. Where does it feel more active and where does it feel more passive? Where do items overlap and where are they alone? Think in general and overall pictures and leave out the details. Don't think about it in terms of making great art. Just think about what you see on this piece of paper. And take a minute to think on this. So pause the recording and come back to it in a minute. Okay, now that you've thought about it, it's time to form a specific idea of the final collage. Imagine the collage you want to create. Make sure you've formed a picture in your mind. Now, in a moment, you will use the materials you gather to construct the collage. Now, you will only have 2 minutes to do this. Do not work past the 2-minute limit. Your job is to place the items you have chosen on the piece of paper. And since you already know the general way you want your collage to look and feel, the composing stage is done. Now it is time for the actions that will bring this creation into physical existence. Are you ready? Get ready to hit go on your 2-minute timer and go. Obviously, pause this podcast. Okay, I'm going to assume now that the 2 minutes is up, so I'm going to say stop. And I want you to look at your collage. How close did it come to your general idea? Do you like the result? Look at it for its own sake, not the fact that you created it. And consider that. And then take everything apart and return the paper back to its blank state. Okay, here's the debrief on that exercise. Whether you liked what you created or not bears no weight as to whether or not you can create or not. Whether you feel energized, whether you are completely focused on the present moment and fully involved with what you are doing. The thing here is the focus was on the collage. It was not on you. And I bet for a lot of people, time passed differently than normal. Because For most people doing this exercise, you would have been focused on the present and therefore there was a sense of timelessness. But here are the essential points for this last and final principle. You started with nothing. You formed a general concept. You moved from general concept to a specific vision of the collage. You formed and held structural tension through the rest of the creative process as you compared your vision to the current state of the collage. You took actions to bring the current state of the collage to its desired level. You used the materials on hand to accomplish the results that you wanted. And then you lived with the creation for a short period after you created it. So that brings me to the final principle, which is create every day. I just showed you how easy it was to create something in 2 minutes or less, and I gave you the formula for how to do it. You have the power to be able to create something new every single day. So there you have it. Now, if you would like a summary sheet of these 7 principles that you can print out to remind you what they are, then go to terrianepalmer.biz/principles. I'll include the link in the show notes below as well. Now, give them all a go and let me know what difference they made to your daily life. Now, I have a special guest next week that I'm sure you will enjoy. We chatted about lots of different things, and it was great to get another person's perspective on some of the ideas that I've been sharing on this podcast. So look out for that episode next week. All right, my friends, thanks for joining me this week. I'll see you next week, same time, same place. Remember, stay inspired and always be creative. Bye for now.